we thank you, Lord, for your precious blood that you shed for us. We thank you, Lord, that you sent your son Jesus to die on the cross, Lord. We thank you, Father, for your forgiveness of sins. Thank you, Father, that you made us the righteousness of in Christ Jesus. Father, we just thank you, Lord, for all that you've done. And we just come in your house, Lord, this morning with great joy and thanksgiving, Lord. We thank you for all that you've done. And we just thank you, Jesus, for what you have in store for us. And we give you all praise, all glory and honor. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise the Lord. We welcome you to the house of the Lord today. Amen. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Oh, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad. Rejoice and be glad. God is doing great and mighty things. Be glad in the Lord. God is fulfilling his word unto us. This is the day that the Lord has made.
You. Ready for battle. Run, run to the battle. For I have told you that before. Do not invite those that are not warriors, that only want to come and eat lunch, but invite the warriors. For it is time to take the land. It's time to go forth and do the things that I have told you that you shall be doing. It's time to stand in your positions, to be conquerors, to be overcomers, to be those that go forth with their armor on, not fearful, not hiding, but realizing they are the conquering foes. They are the force that overcomes the world. They are the force that prepares for the rapture. They are those that go forth to do the things that I have told them to do. Continue to pray for the weather. You notice the weather? They need those that can take control over that. That can take authority. It is not happening here, no. But you better pray for camp meeting that it don't happen here. But you need to be in prayer. It's no longer time just to play church. It's time to be in the Lord's army. It's time to go to battle. It's time to go forth and do the things that I've called upon you to do. For if you don't do them, nobody will. Therefore I say unto you, put on your armor. Arm yourself. For I have not called cowards into my army. I have not called those that walk in fear into my army, for I know they will not do anything except run, cower down, not move forward. But I say unto you, you are the winners, you are the overcomers, and you will go forth in victory. So do not be fearful, for fear is not of me, it's of the devil, you know that. Go forth in your strength. Go forth in your power. Go forth in the things that I have told you to do. Go forth. Go forth. Go forth. For Samson only served me when he had to. Be an Elijah or Elisha. Be a Gideon. Be those that are willing to go forth and conquer and win. Be those that are ready, for I don't need those that are not ready. I have too many of those who are not ready. I need those that are ready, that are willing, that are able. I need the overcomers.
Your church will be a stepping stone for the lost. It will be a place that can come, they can come for safety. Your church will be a place people can come to enter into my presence. It will be a place that they have been looking for because my presence will be there. No longer will preaching be enough. No longer will music be enough. It is my presence that will break the yoke of bondages. It is time for the world to know that the truth will set them free and not the lies of the devil. This is a great and glorious time for my church. The signs are here. The signs are all around. Be aware of them so you will know what is to come. I do not want my children to be caught unaware. The end is near. My return is near. Peace be unto you.
For you know where you fit in, says the Lord. For if you do not know where you fit in, you need to figure that out right now, says the Lord. That you could be in the place that I've called you to be in, says the Lord. That you should be clothed in my armor, that you can go forth and do the things that I've called you to do. Not that you want to do, but what I've called you to do, says the Lord. And it is those that find their position and are willing to fight with me, says the Lord, that my spirit shall fill them to overflowing, says the Lord.
Sweet presence, Lord, I come.
your presence. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Praise the Lord. Isn't it so good to be in the presence of the Lord? Amen. Praise the Lord. We welcome you to the Father's house this morning. Amen. Pastor Dennis.
All right, praise God. Keep her intact there, buddy. All right, well, we're going to worship the Lord in our giving today. Thank you for your faithfulness in all the areas. Why? Our tithes and offerings, our pastor's love offering, those are the two this morning, but we do missions and other things, youth camp, camp meeting. Thank you for your faithfulness in that area, and appreciate that. Praise God. And thank God, God is keeping all the records. Hallelujah. Praise God. So your faithfulness, of course, is being recorded by the Lord Jesus. Praise God. Father, today we thank you for the privilege of giving. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege of sitting in your presence, of enjoying, Father, the worship, Lord, and just entering in. We thank you for all of that. We just ask you to just continue to faithfully take care of everyone, Lord, all their needs, all the things that face each one, Lord. And, Father, we thank you and praise you for it. Amen. All right. Praise God. My. Oh, so many things coming up so fast. Wow. God, of course, keeps talking to us about camp meeting. And be sure and keep that in your prayers, mightily in your prayers. God said he's looking for wimps. No. I'm seeing if you're paying attention. What's he looking for? What? It starts with a W.
Warriors,
yes. All right. What for? The violent will take it by force, right? Amen. We got to be part of that army. Amen. He said he's not looking for what? For people who just want to come and eat. Talking about camp meeting. He's talking about warriors. We need people who are willing to get in the battle and fight the enemy. Amen. Praise God. Wow. What's that? There you go. All righty. Praise God. Amen. Well, keep camp meeting in prayer. You know, God's not talking about some super spiritual person. He's talking about you. Amen? Just yes, Brother Lee.
The old hymn, "I Worked Christian Soldiers Marching as the War," sounds like a fulfillment.
There you go. All right. Just takes normal people that are just willing to stand up against the enemy. Amen? Praise God. And anyhow, that's what the Lord's talking about, so keep that in prayer. Just do what the Lord's telling you to do. Amen? Praise God. Be the person that God says he wants you to be. Amen? Hallelujah. Wow. I was just reading a little excerpt this morning about Alexander Dowie. I believe he was from Australia during the times of the of Great Revival there. One summer, he buried 40 people in his congregation. Some kind of a plague going through the whole area. And he was just distraught, seeking God, and God showed him he needed to stand up against the enemy and stop the thing. And when he did, there was a girl in his church who also was dying. She was healed, and from that time on, they never lost another person. But there's an example of rising up, taking your authority, standing against the enemy who's trying to just kill, steal, and destroy. And so I believe that's what God's calling us to do. Rise up. Don't let the devil do all this stuff. Amen. All right. Anyway, praise God. Well, we do have church tonight. Before that, we have dinner today. K-Rations. No. K-Rations. No, we have dinner today. And we love to have all of you stay, and we thank you for just everything. Praise God. Please stay and be with us. Praise God. We're celebrating June and July birthdays because the next time we would celebrate falls right on camp meeting Sunday, so that won't work for us. We'll be eating anyway, of course, but anyway, we're celebrating all those birthdays today, so keep that in mind. My. All right. Church tonight, Tuesday night, or Monday night, there will be a ball game, providing it doesn't rain. And Tuesday is the last ladies' Bible study for the summer months here, and until September again, they'll start up again. So, ladies, this is your last opportunity on Tuesday night. All right. Hi. All kinds of stuff. I noticed in the back there were registration forms for camp, for youth camp. That is coming up. If you want any children, grandchildren, friends, or whatever that want their kids to come, please get them registered so we know that they're coming and we know how to prepare for that. All right. If you want to help, please talk to Gwen. There's lots of things you can do. You can help my. You can help the cook in the kitchen. You can help in worship. You can help in outside activities. Crafts, yeah. Okay, crafts. There's crafts. All kinds of things. So, you know, amen. All right. Oh, dear. All right, we would like to welcome Mark and Nicole's newest. And is that Elijah or Eli?
Elijah.
Elijah. Okay. I thought I heard yesterday, but I wasn't correct. I wasn't sure. And it's Elijah what?
Daniel.
Oh, Elijah Daniel. Okay, wonderful. All right, praise God. We welcome Elijah in our services today. Praise God. And, of course, we're praying God's richest blessings upon you as you rear him for the Lord. And amen. All right. So, lots of things. All right. Praise God. Anything I'm forgetting? That isn't in here? There's a baby shower here on Friday night, 7 o'clock. Okay. Everybody know about that one? Okay, talk to my wife or Gwen. They'll fill you in. For Elba, yes. And their new little one. All right? That's here on Friday. So keep that in mind. All right. Any questions, please, ladies, see my wife or Gwen. They'll fill you in on all the details. All right. Praise God. All right. I guess we better get moving here. My wife and I are singing. And pastor's preaching. I believe, right?
I believe.
You're preaching, right? All right. Hallelujah. Sorry.
Great. when Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy will fill my heart! Then I shall bow in humble
David, do you have some prayer requests?
Praise the Lord this morning. Jim from Spain says, we need prayer for three people who are blind and need a miracle. Reverend Sam from South Africa says, please pray for three coming who have problems walking and cannot walk without a walker. Bob from Singapore says, we have five coming who have cancer and need a miracle. Reverend Joy from South Africa says, they have seven coming who need a miracle from AIDS. That was a curse put on them by the witch doctor. And they need deliverance. And Little John in Liberia, Mary in Kenya, and David in the Ivory Coast ask us to continue to keep them in their prayers. And also we're praying for Brian and his family today. They need our prayers as well.
Amen. Praise God. Father, we thank you that you've heard this and that you've already moved mightily on their behalf, that they're going to receive the deliverance that they have need of, that there's going to be miracles, the blind are going to see. We thank you, Father God, that you're going to heal, that you're going to deliver and set free. And Father God, we just praise you for that. Now, Father, let my mouth be that of a ready writer. Let me say and do only those things that you want me to say this day. Let every ear be open. For we give unto you all the praise and all the glory in Jesus' name.
Yes, amen.
Glory.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Lord.
I tell you, God spoke some powerful things to us today.
Amen.
I heard an old saying on television this week, glory, and she was telling about the demon activities and the places that she goes to. And she said, the sad part is the Pentecostal church runs from the demons and they don't even know what to do anymore. I thought, how sad. I think, praise God, you got me. I know what to do. You got Lee and Sharon. They know what to do. We're not going to run from any demon. Glory. Hallelujah. I've entitled this song today. I'm going to sing. Did you know that, Dennis? But I'm going to change this. I'm going to entitle this sermon, Changed by Fire.
Wow. Amen.
Changed by Fire. I was changed by fire. And I realized the importance of it. For 13 years, I waited to be filled with the Holy Ghost, simply because the Pentecostal church that I was going to did not really know how to administer that to people. They didn't. They shook your head, beat on your back. You know, they done everything the flesh could possibly do. And they forgot that it had already been given. It wasn't something we were struggling for. It wasn't something we had to wait until we were good enough to get, because if we were saved, we was as good as we're going to get right then. So for 13 years, I was like a yo-yo, up and down. If you were real close to me, you probably didn't know whether I was saved or not saved. That's the truth. And then I went to the state of Washington, not to go to college. That was not the reason we went. Glory. We went to get a better job, J-O-B. And then one night God spoke to me in a dream that wherever Ron DeBoer went that Saturday, I was to go with him because he was going to fill me with the Holy Ghost. And boy, I went. I went. I won't go into the whole details. It was a hard time catching up with Ron, and it was a hard time with Ron catching up with me. And but we went to a Full Gospel Businessmen's Association, and they had a Presbyterian pastor that was preaching that was ahead of all the Presbyterian churches until he got kicked out. They said he was crazy because he got baptized in the Holy Ghost. Glory. And don't ask me what he preached that morning, because he was giving his testimony. I wasn't interested. I wanted him to shut his mouth, stop preaching, and have the altar call, please. Because God had said I was going to receive something. And I came like you should come to church every Sunday, expecting. I just wanted to get to that altar. That's where I wanted to be. The man was doing things different than I'd ever seen him. Matter of fact, our Full Gospel Church had told us that was wrong. And so the devil was reminding me that. Who did I say was reminding me? The devil. Wasn't God. Because God said, if you go there, I'll fill you. And so the devil is saying, this is not the way you get filled. You know this. You know, sometimes as Christians, we don't even weigh out what's going on. And we don't know whether it's God talking or the devil. That's sad. Because the devil talks to us more times than God does. Until we know God's voice, then we just won't listen to the devil's. So that morning, I got baptized with the Holy Ghost. Just like it said in the Bible. I'm not telling you you have to be baptized this way, but everybody standing in that line saw the fire come right down through the floor and come right down and set right on the top of my head until I was filled. And I left that place changed by fire. Change by fire. I didn't putz around and maybe never read the Bible and leave it set on the shelf and gather dust. I went through the Bible 3 times in less than a year. I prayed so loud at night when I was laying on bed in the spirit, I'd wake everybody up in the house and we'd wonder who was talking. There had been a change by the fire. And when we get baptized in the Holy Ghost, we're all supposed to change like that. I'm not saying we're supposed to have the fire, but there should be a change. There should be a change. If you could ask David, he would tell you from the time we left New York State until I quit to go to college, there is a big change. There is a big change. I was still a lot like I was before I was saved. Don't pull up behind me and blow your horn and give me the finger. Because you definitely would know, because I'd jerk you right out of that car. There were some changes that weren't done, but after that day, things begin to change. Glory. Proverbs 30, verse 15 and 16. four things that say, not it is enough. One's the fire. Fire is never satisfied. It will burn as long as there is fuel. Hebrews 12:29. For out of our God is a consuming fire. For our God is a consuming fire. I'll tell you, when he sets us on fire, we're on fire. And we flow much different than we did before. When we look at the lives of those like God talked to us about this morning, it was interesting words. He told me these things. I knew I was going to have them in my sermon. He said he's not looking for people who are just coming to eat. He's looking for warriors. Because the warriors won't do nothing. They may talk the talk, but they won't walk the walk. Glory. Hallelujah. I remember one time we went to see a man about renting his ground for a tent meeting here in New York State. And a man by the name of Ike was kind of setting me up a little bit. Because he wanted me to be like I was when I left here. And I had changed. Glory. And I got over there to talk to the guy about renting his land out back because it was a good place to have a tent meeting. And he began to go off on Christians. You guys always want something free. You always want this. You always want that. I said, I didn't come here to get anything free. I'm willing to pay you. Blah, 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 blah. And that's what Ike wanted. Glory. I had my grandson with me. I had two grandsons with me. Big, tall, lanky Dustin. Jamie, when he was big and wrestling age. And I had Adam Coombs. And all at once, this guy that owned that place, he crossed the line. He said, I'll throw you right out of this place. Boy, I come out of my seat and I looked right at him and said, it's been done before. If you want to try, just come on around. And these guys are out the door. God is looking for people like that. Elijah stormed right in before the king. He said, I got a word for you from God. It's not going to rain. Now, how in the world did he get in as far as the king? You know, he didn't hide around the corner and peek and wait and say, hey, look, I got some money. Hey, you go give the king some money that I can talk to him. No, he just walked right on in. I mean, we go through the Bible, we see a lot of things like this. And because we're getting to the end right now, I believe with all my heart, God is looking for those that are going to speak up, for those that aren't afraid, for those that are willing to spread the gospel. Not be wishy-washy, but speak up. And I heard this lady say that, and God already had told me. She said, after my great-grandmother stood for 3 weeks under the big tent in St. Louis, Missouri, froze there with her finger up, not moving, the tent filled up. And people began to stay day and night. What in the world is this woman doing? What's happening here? I mean, she's not sitting down. She's not sleeping. She's not eating. She's not drinking. She's just standing there with a finger out. And when she come out of it, they said she picked up right where she left off preaching and continued her message. By then, she got their attention. She got their attention. They realized that, hey, this is supernatural. Nobody in the natural can do these things. Last year in camp meeting, God said we started the revival. I may remember that sermon. He says this year, we're going to start flowing in the gifts of the Spirit, not the flesh. He said if somebody starts to speak real loud and run off at the mouth in the flesh, you may be carrying them out. So I'm warning you ahead of time. We've seen days in the Bible of Ananias and Sapphira. We don't want to see them in our tent meeting. We want to see the Spirit move. But he says when the Spirit starts moving, it may not stop. It may not break for lunch. It may not break for supper. It may not break until we go home at 10 or 11, 12 o'clock at night. If we allow it to flow. If we allow it to flow. If we don't just sit there on our gifts and say, well, the Spirit didn't move on me. Oh, yeah? Did you notice our sister came this morning with a message? This one, which she don't normally do. She had all wrote out. What did it say? Wasn't that confirmation? It's not going to be a church that just hides. It's not going to be a church that goes someplace and they talk about us, that we don't speak up. Glory. It's going to be a church that stands up and speaks up. We moved back to Cortland from Ithaca after we got saved, and we rented a little place out on Route 90 that had spring water and an outhouse, and we had fun. But my wife worked at Smith Krona at that time, and these two guys picked her up and took her in and brought her home so I didn't have to, because she worked nights. And she comes home, she said, you know this guy? Bang, bang, bang. I said, no. He's from Groton. I said, oh. I don't know him. This is before I'm really baptized in the Holy Spirit yet. She says that he's not afraid of you. He's beat you up. I said, which? Well, come time for him to pick her up, I was out there. I got out of the car and I grabbed him right by the shirt and I jerked him right up. I said, now take a close look at me. Do you know me? No, I don't think so. I said, well, you told my wife you beat me up. Why don't you try it again so that I'll know it too? And that was the end of it. He didn't want none of that. The guy in the car from Homer, he said, I told you. I'd keep my mouth shut. Glory. But, you know, it sounds like a crazy message, I know. But as Christians, we're starting to sound like that anymore. Somebody says something and we'll put the gag on. Why? Are we ashamed of who we are? I'm not asking you to go out and have fist fights in that sense. but we better stand up for the gospel. Glory. You need to read Luke's. Everybody talks about Matthew 24, 25, you know. Well, try reading Luke's, because Luke has a different interpretation about these last days. He tells us when we go out two by two anymore, make sure we take our purse with us in case we have to buy something. Remember, they weren't to take it before? And if it wasn't accepted, they were to shake the dust off their feet. And Luke says, oh, by the way, also, if you haven't got a sword, you better buy one and take it with you. What? You know what saved those cops up in Massachusetts? They'd come ready. They had heard that somebody was out there and was going to cut their head off. They backed up first, yes, because they're supposed to. They're supposed to ask you nice and kindly to surrender. Well, this guy wouldn't have none of that, so bang, 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 and it was all over for that guy, and they still had their heads on. We're getting ready to see things here in the United States that we never should see. They said on the news they were talking with some of those running for the president, and they said there's over 400,000 down in by the border in Mexico, not in Texas. Perry guarantees us they're not there. But they belong to the United Nations. They've got their vehicles. They've got everything. And as soon as we have another city that gets out of hand because of what's going on, we're going to have United Nations troops walk on our streets. That's not good. That is not good. And if we're not willing to stand up for God, He's not going to be able to stand up for us. Think about that. You know, we need to be changed. If you haven't got that spirit of Elijah in there, get changed. Because the Bible says His spirit is going to be operating in the days that we're living in. That goes for you women. Glory. And it's not just going to be mouth talking. Glory. We got our sister over there sitting next to Dan. I guarantee you, if she tells you to move, you better move. Glory. Strange message. Have you been changed by fire? What does fire do? It purifies us. It takes all the bad things out so that we're operating in perfect holiness, that we're operating like God wants us to operate. You see, when we used to cast out a lot of demons, not by choice. That was a gift God gave to me. It was the first gift He ever gave to me, very first one. And I was sitting in a church running the Saturday night prayer meeting. I didn't want to. My pastor assured me there's nothing to it. All you do is sing a couple worship songs, ask for somebody got a testimony or a song, and we sing it. You know, that started working out pretty good. I'm just a green kid back then, filled with the Holy Ghost, when this lady stands up and instantly the Spirit of God said, she has a demon. I said, yes, ma'am. And she said, I come here tonight to kill the pastor. She didn't know who the pastor was. And I'm the one on the platform. And I thought, oh boy, Lord, here we go. But you know, nothing happened. She finally got delivered. I learned more about deliverance. And I understood what God wanted. He wanted us to stand like warriors, like he said. He wanted us to be strong. He wanted us to be open to the flowing and the moving of the gift. I mean, when he wants to move, and we just sit there and don't do nothing, or we get off in the flesh, that stops her. I've heard that many times. Oh, I hate that. Somebody start praying, they know they haven't got tongues or interpretations yet. Now they're just going like mad, and everybody else stops. That's the end of the moving of the Spirit for the night. Oh, how sad. We want everybody to flow in the gifts. But make sure it's the Spirit and not you. That's the problem the Pentecostal church has had for over years. He told us way before anything started moving up there in Canada. He told us right in our church down here. As before that started moving. As a matter of fact, he confirmed it the next week. Glory. Almost word for word. I never went there myself. I delivered many that went there from other places. There was only one church in Syracuse that seemed like it knew this was all false. You know how much false is flowing right now? It's unbelievable. And most Christians don't know whether it's truth or false. We need to learn what is God and what isn't God. At one time here in Cortland, the most on fire church was the one that was receiving the most flack and fighting over it because they thought the pastor was off the wall. And I had a nephew that I taught all these bad things. And I went down there because I was concerned. I wanted to see if the guy was right because I had a nephew there and I didn't want him in the false. I would have said so right in the whole church too. Only everything I saw was of God. It's just Cortland was so far behind, they'd never seen people falling in the Spirit before. Oh, he may have had some problems. I'm not saying he didn't have none. But that was a going church. And after they stopped allowing him to flow there, he gave up on the Lord. We're trying to get him back now. Is that right, Lefty? Huh? He can't always hear. But I guarantee he won't back down anymore. Glory. We got people here that won't back down. We need to be ready. I don't know what's going to happen. Everything that's going to happen this camp meeting. But I can guarantee you we'll probably have deliverance. It won't be the first time. We had a demon stand around on the sidewalk and argue and fight with Dennis until I stepped up and began to talk. And then she was brought there by a spirit-filled person from this church that thought she was on. I'll tell you, we need to find out what is what. Because I know there's going to be healings. I know there's going to be miracles. I know lives are going to be changed. We had a bus pull in here during camp meeting once. Remember that? They never come back. He's preached for us before. You know why they never come back? They had a whole bunch of people with the shakes. Yeah, we cast those spirits right out and openly told them what was going on, and they kind of believed it was all right, so they didn't want to bring their people back down here again. And that was all right with me. That was fine with me. I had no problem with that. Glory. And we, lots of times when we were trying to teach people, we'd tell them, birds of a feather do what? When they're coming to you, you better go find out what's inside of you. You need to get cast out. Because if they're not afraid of you, that should tell you something. Now, I should speak up big. They tell me, and I believe it's probably true, you could rent an auditorium of 1,000 people and put nothing but straight people in there, and then put a gay in there. And if there's somebody else in there that's hiding in the closet, guess what? They're coming out. Because that gay will go right to them. Like a magnet, right to them. Why? Birds of a feather flock together. Glory. We see it. They were showing before I left house, it's not even in my message, but they were showing a boy that must have been 10, 11 years old. And they're having a lot of problems now with pedophiles and things like this because they've got more freedom now. And the parents said, there's absolutely no way that they'll fool my son. So the actor had went to the house a day or two before and tried to sell him some home repairs. Met the little boy and said hi. Parked down the street and waited for him to come out. Knew his name and everything. He called him by name. Oh, can you help me put this stuff in my van? Kid got right in the van. And the parents said, oh no, I thought we trained them better. Have you trained your children about those things? I sure hope so. It says train up a child. And when he's old, he'll not go that way. You know, are we telling them? Are we warning them? I mean, is the fire burning so hot in us we've got to tell them these things? We need to stand up. Stand up and be counted. God's determined that your life and my life is on fire. Hebrews 1:7. And of the angels, he said, who maketh his angels spirits and his ministers a flame of fire? How many ministers do we have in here? That's right, every one of us. Every one of us. Are you on fire? Or have you cooled down? Just not ministers on fire. That scripture verse says ministers of fire. Why do you think my son David been preaching on that every time that he does? What do you think David over here has been preaching on? Why do you think Randy's been preaching on it? God's trying to get us on fire. He realized what's coming and we're not ready. We're not ready. A lot of people just come to our camp meeting for the food. I mean, we have a lot of good food. Boy, do we ever. Glory. And please don't volunteer to work in our little kitchen. I heard Dennis when he said that this morning. I thought, oh, no. In that tiny kitchen they got up there that Carol's in, please don't get too many people in there or you're walking all over each other. The last thing I want, when I'm in a kitchen and I'm doing the cooking, the last thing I want is a bunch of people getting in my way that I can't go by, I can't move, I want to take this out. They're trying to turn things over before it's time for them to be turned over. I don't need help. Glory. Let me do it. You feel like that too? If I asked you how to make speckled gravy, you hear them say that in the old Western. How many here knows how to make speckled gravy? Oh, come on. It's speckled gravy any way you want to call it. You better get some type of grease, oil, flour, salt and pepper, get it browned up to wherever you want to brown it, and brown it a little bit more, and then take a little milk and put it in it. Don't let it get thin. Keep it thick. Oh, that's good. Oh, that's good. Glory. And if you're fortunate enough to have a little beef stock or pork stock, we found a new restaurant that wasn't too bad. We should have never went back, and we could have said, hey, we found a good one. We went for prime rib. It's still on the sermon now. And it had so much grizzle in it, it was what you call a schlecht. He went to the store and bought the schlecht. You know what the bottom cut is? Schlecht. That's as low down as you can go. He should have been selling prime. Age prime. So we thought, oh, he's just trying to save some money. So I really had a hunger for some liver and onions. And so my wife went and got liver and onions. How many like liver and onion? This liver was cut so thin, it was paper thick. Now, how in the world can you taste liver when it's cut that? Liver should be about a half inch thick. Then you get that good flavor, right? I'll tell you, you don't want paper. It would have had a good flavor, I think, if it had been thicker. You know what? Most restaurants that are good are afraid to raise their price because they're afraid people won't come back. But if you want good food, they've got to raise their price. I can buy you select prime rib for $8 a pound. And where's my pizza man? He's in there. Oh, back there. You would even serve it on pizza, would you? Now, if I go buy you prime, it's going to cost you $15. Oh, no. I can go to the restaurant and buy it cooked for that. No, you cannot. I'll tell you, my daughter cooks it for us every Christmas, and you don't really need a sharp knife. A butter knife. A butter knife will cut it. And it's so good and so tender. Why? It's been aged. It's groomed for that. God's trying to age us and groom us for what we're supposed to be. And when the devil sticks a fork in us and said, coming out, in Jesus' name, this knife comes out sharper than any two-edged knife. We prove who God is. If somebody sits there in a wheelchair and don't get out, does that prove God really is there? I don't think so. I've seen it many times. But I don't think so. We had a lady almost die here last year. We had to go find the golf cart and load her in it and take her in the tent. And then we had one of these false Christians. He got right up there. He wanted to pray. And everybody was going to move out of his way. Not me when I got in there. I want this lady to get her a miracle. She's still living this year, and we'll be here this year. You know, they generally want to run right up there. They'll tell you all about their healing ministry. And if you listen careful, you'll think, yeah, God can do that, but this does not sound like what God does. I know a God that if you need a miracle, it'll make you repent of all your sins before he'll give it to you. I've seen it. Had two people in wheelchairs. Both had the same problem. God said, tell them, I cannot heal them until they repent. So that's what I had to tell them. You know, it's a funny thing. I never prayed for them again. They just sat up there embarrassed at first, humiliated at first, until finally they humbled themselves and realized what I was saying was true. And I don't know when it happened, but they repented. And all at once we hear the whole auditorium going crazy, and here these two people are up walking while I'm dealing with a demon-possessed mother, father, and a boy. That all come in because of those people come that way. If they hadn't come that way, the demon wouldn't have dared come. They know me. I don't brag that. They'll look right at, oh, you're Don Evans. I know who you are. And I said, yeah, and you know you got to go, too. I had one tell me you've had luck with lesser demons than me. But I'm the one, this is where he made a mistake. I'm the one that killed Jesus Christ. I says, you're a liar, too. Nobody killed Jesus Christ. He gave his life. Well, you still can't cast. Well, I cast him out. God showed me you're standing right behind the guy talking. I said, you're a liar there too, because you're standing right behind him. Well, I'll come back after you go. The guy opened the door and let him. Glory. God wants to do some things this year, and I think some of them are going to be strange to many of you. Things you haven't seen. We're going back to when we first come back to Cortland. We had the warlock in our church. How many remember him? Glory. He'd sit back there and throw spells all service. Glory. And we left him there because we thought we could reach him. Glory. We've had them come here. The very Sunday, I think it was a Sunday, but the very day that Kevin come to meet Gwen for the first time, we had another fella come down the driveway too. And I knew the minute he was on the driveway because the hair on the back of my neck was all standing up. And God had sent him here to marry Gwen. How many remember that? Oh, yes. And we let him know we knew who he was, too, and that never happened. Glory. But so wonder nobody said anything. I don't know. Kevin's kind of a quiet boy. That guy was no small guy. And he was used to rough and tumbling and fighting. Would anybody have stood up and said, well, my son David, I think, was still here. He knew he would have. He said, that's it, bro. Hit the road, right down that road right now. So the guy stays around. I come down to church, and he's got two of our teenagers in my office talking to him. That's when he left. I told him, now, one other year, we had a guy come down and sleep out here. Remember that? I went down, threw him off the property, and everybody said, well, you can't be doing that. You can't be doing that. You're getting too old, Pastor. This is my flock. I'm the shepherd. I try to watch over the sheep a little bit. I wasn't afraid of that guy. He left. Matter of fact, I personally drove him to Dryden and dropped him off at the library to make sure he left. Then the next year we had another one come too, didn't we? Yeah, we did. I think David run him off. Glory. Sharon said, just call the sheriff. He'll leave. Which is true. But I'm just sharing this with you because I believe things are going to happen this year like we've never seen before. There's absolutely nothing to be afraid of. Nothing. Glory.
Because God will be on your side.
That's right.
God will be taking care of you.
Amen.
And I've never hit anybody with my fist with the power that God can give you. And so if they went down very easy without the power of God, how much quicker will they go down? Glory. Hallelujah. Glory. Get ready. Let the fire change you. Become everything that God wants you to be. Glory. We've got Rob and Randy and David. Rob's real little. But you can never accuse him of backing down. I don't think he knows how. Right, Rob? He ain't saying nothing. Glory. He has to put up with me, you know. Now we get along real good. Father, if anybody needs a touch, if they need the fire, right now, we just commit this whole service into your hand, in Jesus' name. Amen.
We have communion today, Pastor.
If you want prayer, we're here.
We have communion.
Oh, that's right. We have that communion. I like communion, but sometimes I wish we never had it. Always seems about we're ready to go do something else. We got communion. We also got food out there.